When I was little, I would try to like leave my body and it wasn't really working. But when I discovered lucid dreaming, I was like, oh my gosh, this is an experience where everything around you feels real, but it's all a creation of your mind. And so to me, it was like an amazing way to dialogue with parts of yourself that you don't normally get to see. My name is Karen Konkoly, and I specialize in lucid dreaming. There's a lot of different ideas. A lot of people are throwing out ideas about why we dream. So one way to look at that question is, when you dream of something, what are the consequences after that? And, you know, did dreaming develop like evolutionarily in order to have those functions? So some ideas about the functions of dreaming are that dreams could help us like depotentiate emotions. If you have an emotional experience during the day, then if you dream about it, it helps you kind of remember the important parts of that emotional memory without re-experiencing all of the like nervous system activation associated with it. There's another idea that dreams help us, integrate the new information that we've learned with our whole corpus of knowledge and kind of understand the deeper meanings of the events that we experience every day and how those can be useful for the future. There's also a lot of ideas about how dreams could help us simulate like social situations or threats to help us kind of broadly prepare for the future. And then there's also, you know, a different set of theories about, well, if something happens during the day, how does that create dreams? And so a big theory is just that dreams are continuous with our current concerns and preoccupations during the day. Instead of kind of coming up with my own grand theory, I've been thinking about ways that we can test the different theories that already exist, because there's a lot of great theories that have been thinking a lot about dreaming, but the problem is that we haven't really had a good method to like alter dreams systematically. And so if we can't alter the variable that we're studying, it's really difficult to make like scientific conclusions that are causal about that variable. And so if we could have a method to like alter dreams systematically, then we could actually start to test which of these theories hold up, you know, and not just correlationally, but causally. One out of every two people will have at least one lucid dream at some point in their life. And about 20% of people have lucid dreams more often, like once a month or more. And so lucid dreaming is said to be a learnable skill. There are a bunch of techniques that you can do to increase your lucid dreaming, but some people are also just natural lucid dreamers and they have them naturally all the time. It seems like lucid dreaming happens during REM sleep, so like the, you know, normal stage of sleep that you're in when you're dreaming also contains lucid dreaming, but maybe it's during times where the normal REM sleep is particularly activated. So when you're in REM sleep, you're paralyzed, but you're twitching and your eyes are moving. And so maybe during lucid dreams, your eyes are moving even more. Maybe you're twitching even more. It's during those active parts. And maybe there are some differences in your brain. Maybe you're a little bit more conscious, maybe some frontal regions or like a network of brain regions becomes more active when you're lucid dreaming, but there aren't like a ton of definitive conclusions about the neural correlates of lucid dreaming because of small sample sizes. So in the lab, what we've tried to do is basically add everything together we can think of that will help people have lucid dreams and do it like all at the same time. So first, we do recruit people that are already good at lucid dreaming. We've done some studies where we've taken novices and those have had lucid dreams as well, but it kind of increases our chances if we can get experienced lucid dreamers to start with. We do overnight studies, and so one thing that's really effective for helping people have lucid dreams is a period of sleep interruption in the middle of the night. So what we do with our participants is at 4 a.m., we wake them up for about half an hour and we have them think about the task. This arousal in the middle of the night can help people's brains stay a little bit more awake and have more lucid dreams in the second half of the night. So then what we do is we use a method that my colleagues and I have recently developed called targeted lucidity reactivation. And so what the method is as people are falling asleep for 20 minutes, we present sound cues like beep, 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 or also light cues sometimes, like a flashing red light. And then each cue is associated with a lucid mindset even while the participant's awake. So we give them a meditation that's like, as you notice the cue, you become lucid. Bring your attention to your thought. Notice where your mind has wandered. We play the cue without the meditation, and then when people fall asleep and enter REM sleep, we're sitting there in the other room monitoring their sleep. And so when they enter REM sleep, then we start presenting the sound cues again with hopes that they'll get incorporated into the participant's dream. So in their dream, they'll hear the beep, 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 and then realize that they're dreaming, and then do our experimental task. Kind of a big obstacle of dreaming research is kind of the limitations that you have about dream reporting. So if somebody has a dream, then they wake up, you kind of don't know the extent to which their dream was distorted or forgotten. And also, you don't necessarily have good timing precision, like you don't know when that dream took place in their brain. So with lucid dreaming research, we've known since the 80s that lucid dreamers can communicate out of a dream by using eye signals. So if you are in a dream, you're totally paralyzed except for your eyes. And so when your eyes look left, right, left, right, left, right, we can monitor that with electrodes next to the eyes and see that their eyes are moving at this large, steady, rapid pace that doesn't normally occur when you are dreaming. And so then we can measure objectively, okay, they agreed to do that signal before sleep, and now they're signaling out to us and we can see it in real time. So we like know what they're dreaming about before they even wake up. So we've known that people can do that for a while. And then we've also known that people can get sounds incorporated into their dreams. So like if you've ever had the sensation of your alarm clock getting incorporated into your dream instead of waking you up, you know that, you know, you can be in a dream and still hear a sound from, you know, this other world. These methods haven't been used much together, and so we wanted to say, okay, can a dreamer hear an entirely new question that they didn't know was coming and then answer it all while staying asleep? Can we prove that they've really heard this sound and have all of the cognitive capabilities available to answer it? And so that's what we did. We got dreamers to answer math problems. The answers were all below 4. So for instance, we would ask 8 minus 6 and the dreamer would answer 2. And then we did this research at Northwestern, but then we also collaborated with 3 other labs around the world who asked the dreamers different sorts of questions and had different sorts of response modalities to demonstrate that two-way communication is a possible and robust phenomenon. The reason why we were so interested in this topic, like a really great application in my mind, is that the entire field of psychology is based a lot on people who are awake. You know, how are people's memories when they're awake? How is people's decision making when they're awake? How is their attention when they're awake? You know, what is the correlates of consciousness when you're awake? And if you have the ability to communicate in real time two ways with somebody who's asleep in a dream, you can start to maybe translate some of these psychological findings to people in a whole other state of consciousness that's still natural and normal for people, but kind of unexplored in terms of how you can like apply rigorous scientific methods to another state of consciousness that was previously inaccessible. In terms of the negative effects of lucid dreaming, I think that one way to think about it is that it may be contraindicated for certain populations. So techniques that help you have lucid dreams, one of them is like reality checking. So all the day, throughout the day, you do something that reminds you to think about whether you're awake or dreaming. So you could like try to stick your finger through your palm, and if it goes through, you're dreaming. And so if somebody is like in the prodromal stages of psychosis or something like that, then this might not be very good exercise for them, just because like for certain people, like maintaining a steady sense that you're in grounded in reality is important. And so maybe for people that like have schizophrenia or something like that, lucid dreaming is not that helpful. And then there's a whole other set of ideas about, well, does lucid dreaming interfere with restful sleep? And so I do get emails sometimes from people who have lots of lucid dreams and they say that they're not getting restful sleep. And it's something hasn't been studied and it would be really interesting to study. From the research that I've done, if you are training to have a lucid dream and you have like one lucid dream or, you know, a lucid dream every now and then, people often feel like way happier the next day. They feel less stressed and more vigorous. They just had this amazing lucid dream. But for, you know, people that are lucid dreaming all the time, it could be that sleep fragmentation is known to increase lucid dreaming. So if you press the snooze button a lot, or if you wake up in the middle of the night, having fragmented sleep can also lead you to be tired or to have other negative consequences. And so it might not be that the lucid dreams in and of themselves are less restful, but that they're a consequence of fragmented sleep that is less restful. Lucid dreaming is also definitely used sometimes as a treatment for nightmares. And I think the important piece there is you can have a nightmare that's lucid, but is still a nightmare. And so I think the really important piece to focus on that some of my colleagues are researching more is the aspect of lucid control is really important. So if you have a nightmare, you need to have a little bit of lucid control, or even non-lucid control, to be able to influence the nightmare to be less scary. So that's definitely a positive benefit that you could get. And I think even for healthy people, there's just really cool benefits that you can get, like learning about yourself. You know, you can shout into your dream, like, show me, you know, something that I could heal from myself or something. And you can have all these magical experiences by interacting with your lucid dreams.